morning, Betty.
Good morning, Jody.
Betty Condon, one of our Southerners.
You're
and,
right.
And who's kept her, I don't think you call it a twang, but...
An accent, accent.
An accent. It's so beautiful. I'm always fascinated. So what part of the South?
Charleston, South Carolina.
And aren't there some of our sisters ministering in Charleston right now?
Beverly Stark and Mary Trasco. They're the only two. They're both retired.
And
but they do work.
And also in South Carolina is Kingstree.
Yes. Trina McCormick.
At Springbank
yes.
Retreat
mm-hmm.
Center.
Right.
That Springbank is dear to your heart, isn't it?
Well, I spent 15 years of my life there.
How did that come about?
Three different times.
How did the first time come about?
First time came about because I was living with the sisters in Georgetown, South Carolina, and we closed that school. And Father John Egan, who was in charge of Springbank, invited me to come and live there.
One of our Dominican brothers.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Was he special in your life?
For 20 years he was. Oh. Beautiful. Wonderful friendship.
Mm-hmm. So you worked with him at Springbank,
and for six years.
What did that mean, working with him, and what was your ministry exactly?
I taught in an all-black school, mm-hmm. and I taught through the integration with an all-white school.
But you lived at Springbank?
Yes, and I lived at Springbank.
When did it evolve into a retreat center then?
Well, a little bit even then, but later on, after... Father Egan had left, and it was closed for a year. And then I was living with Jerry Magel and Shirley Levesque in Columbia, and they talked about reopening it. And then it was a retreat center again.
So and you were there at least, what, six more years?
Yeah, mm-hmm. before I went to Kenya.
When did Sister Ursula Ording and Sister Trina McCormick come into the picture?
They had lost the place where they were giving retreats and needed a place to be. So Sister Ellen Robinson, who was my co-provincial, asked me to go up and talk with them. And I invited them to come down the following year.
And then you left the country.
Well, I was 1 year I coordinated with Ursula, and then I thought she could take over. So then I went to Kenya.
You just got on the boat and went to, I should say, ship.
No, I knew, you know, the sister that was there, she had been at Springbank 5 years, C.L. Evers, mm-hmm. a Racine Dominican.
So was it for vacation or for?
Retreat center.
A retreat, another retreat
yeah.
center.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
That, did you need to learn the language?
I just learned a few greetings, that's all.
A few greetings?
Mm-hmm. The people, anyone who had been to school knew English.
So retreat for adults, I presume?
Yes, uh-huh. And mostly professionals.
Were you able to come to know the people well? I mean, those native to the
one
African culture?
One of the wonderful experiences I had was that right near where we live was a Muslim village. And we invited the women to come over. C.L. Evers, the sister with me, was a craftsperson. And 12 of them came. Only two of them knew English because the older ones hadn't had a chance to go to school. But we met once a week. And I was Seal's assistant, and we made all kind of nice little things.
So you really got to know somewhat the not only the Muslims, but their through these women, their culture
oh, yes.
also.
Yes.
How could
and
you
we
not
could
love them?
And we could go them? And visit them. You know, they were always welcoming to us, and they would always have a little drink, a bittersweet, which was a Coke drink, I think. Because they knew we couldn't drink the water.
Yeah, so no one could drink the water?
Well, I don't know if the native people did, but we didn't.
Because?
Well it could make you sick.
Oh, my. Oh, my. Or put something in the water
we
make
would,
it pure,
yeah,
purified.
We would filter it and boil it,
mm-hmm.
both. before we drank it.
Well, what a beautiful experience. Did you travel while you were there in Kenya to other parts of Africa?
A little
bit.
Went over to Lake Victoria one time and took a little vacation over there. And another time we went to Mombasa, to the coast, and took a little vacation there.
Was it difficult coming back to the United States?
Well, I came back for chapters.
Oh.
And while I was back, my older sister got seriously sick. And I had a round-trip ticket. Then I, as one of the sisters was there, said I took her to the plane and she never came back. I ended up staying 3 years with my sister.
And that's in Charleston?
Yes.
Charleston. Mm-hmm. As I recall, you and Barbara Hubbard opened another retreat center.
We
so
did.
This is your third retreat.
That's right.
And where was that located?
On a little island called Edisto off the southeast coast of South Carolina.
I love the name. I remember
Indian name. It's from Indians, Edisto Indians.
Oh.
They used to be there. They were no longer there when we were there. Quite a few northerners came down during the winter, and they formed different organizations, and we were a part of most of those, you know, to get to know the people. And we were a part of the Ministerial Alliance, so we went to all the churches, white and black. Every once a month we went to one of the churches. So.
And people came to your retreat center? It was called Sea of Peace, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, Sea of Peace.
Yes, for a day or overnight or?
Oh, yeah, or a week. And we had a few people that of our sisters who were made it part of their sabbatical, and they came for a month. And Liam is one of the ones that I can think of offhand.
Mm-hmm. That's closed. That facility's closed now,
yes,
hasn't it?
Yes.
Yes. And it belonged to the congregation, did it not?
Yes.
Yes.
It did.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know you must have had a life before your retreat ministry.
Well, I taught school for about 25 years, I guess. Mm-hmm. But when I had my choice, then I went into retreat work.
When you were young and in your prime, I mean, like, ready for school, grade school, did you have our sisters in school in Charleston?
No.
They weren't there yet?
No. There were the native group of sisters. There were charities of Our Lady of Mercy, and I had them in grade school and in high school, plus some of the diocesan priests taught in the high school. But then I wanted to go to Catholic college, so I ended up at Barry College.
Did you find that name in the Sunday Visitor? Or?
No, I had a cousin that went there for a year before, so that's how I knew about it. And I wanted to, I was in a Catholic grade school, Catholic high school, and I wanted to be in a Catholic college. And I loved the sisters there.
At Barry.
That's how. They in a sense, gave me my vocation.
Those were the early years, I would imagine, of Barry.
The third year.
Mm. So Sister Dorothy and who else?
I had been back for my 50th anniversary.
Oh. Yeah. Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Sister Dorothy Brown, I presume, was a...
Yeah, but Mary Paul is the one that I remember so much. She was like a little mother to us.
And Nori
McHugh. And Mary Jane Hart, another one that I loved, you know. And Loyola taught me Latin. In those days, we studied Latin.
And then you your own study led you to what topic or what?
Oh, it was social studies there. And then I went to Catholic U for my graduate work in American history.
Was our House of Studies?
Yeah, Sister Ursula was the superior.
In the early years of the House of Studies.
Yeah.
Yes. Were there other communities living there at the time?
It seemed to me, I just remember our sisters anyway. That's what I remember.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
We had to take a little bus ride to get to the university.
So did Barry ask you to come back and teach then once you completed?
Only in the summer did I teach. Mm-hmm. But I was teaching first grade during the year and college during the summer for 10 years. But I didn't think of myself as a college teacher, so mm-hmm. when I had a choice, I didn't do that anymore. Well, then I was in retreat work anyway.
You must have had other siblings. How many?
I have two brothers.
Two brothers.
And two sisters.
How were your mother and...
Really, three sisters, because I had a sister who died when she was 13 when I was just three. But five of us were raised together.
And are you the living member right now?
I'm the only one. My younger sister died last year.
May I ask your age?
91.
And now living in Maria.
Yeah, just since about November.
Mm-hmm. May I ask you this? What was your mother and father's reaction when you shared with them your desire to become an Adrian Dominican?
I was reading my autobiography the other day, and I remember my mother said, I was like the rose in her garden that God picked.
Oh, that probably makes you cry right now.
Yeah. And my dad always had that little prayer, you know, I'm the father of a nun. He always carried that. You know, they were very proud.
Mm-hmm. What was his profession?
He was a merchant. My grandparents started a department store, and then the three sons worked in it, and the grandsons worked in it. It was a department store that lasted for over 100 years.
Oh my. Right in Charleston.
Right in Charleston. Yeah. Since it was a family, you know, it was hard to keep up.
Did you ever serve as a clerk in the store?
No, I never did. My brothers did, but I didn't.
wasn't a young girl's job.
Evidently.
Evidently. Those must have been very happy years, though.
Yes, we had a summer home on the beach, you know.
In South Carolina.
In South Carolina, yes. So every summer we moved over to the beach.
No wonder you were drawn to Sea of Peace.
Yeah, well, I loved Catherine of Siena, and when Barbara Hubbard and I gave retreats, we often took the mystics, and we often took Catherine. So, you know, as the fish is in the sea, and the sea is in the fish, so am I in you, and you in me, Sea of Peace.
Oh, beautiful.
Catherine's quote.
Beautiful.
We went to see the bishop to tell him what we wanted to do, and he said, what is the name of your place? And we said, oh, we haven't got a name. So we went home and we wrote down, I guess, about 10 names, and we picked that one.
Did anyone else come to join you as staff besides you?
No,
and Barbara?
No, it wasn't that big. It was just the two of us. But we were ecumenical, you know, because it's not a very Catholic area. So, and I also had done a two-year spiritual direction program under the auspices of two Episcopal women. So we often had people from that program come to our place. But we had over 60 of our sisters, so we were real proud of that come.
Yeah, that's quite amazing.
Yeah.
As they did... or I don't know if they continue to do it, Spring Break, too.
Well,
our sisters.
We're older now, you know.
Yes.
So many of us that used to go on retreat don't retreat right here at home.
Right. And in the comfort of our home. Could you share a little bit about Shirley Levesque? Because I know she's one of our sisters who died quite young.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How would you describe her?
Oh, I loved Shirley. Mm-hmm. She was full of fun. And she had broken her leg, I think, when she and Jerry were down in the southern part of the state. And so she ended up staying with us at Springbank for quite a while she recuperated. But later on then, after I was provincial. Anyway, I lived with the two of them in Columbia, and I loved them both.
Now, you just slipped in when I was a provincial. When did that happen in your lifetime?
I was at Springbank. Mm-hmm. I had been there 6 years. And there were 10 of us nominated, and we had to each give a talk. And I thought, oh, well, you know, I won't be elected. But I was. There were four of us, because we were co-provincials then.
Who were you?
We were in provinces. Maria Riley, Grace Doherty, and Catherine McKillop.
What a great group.
Yeah.
Yes.
More. It was.
And did you live in West Palm?
In West Palm, yeah, mm-hmm. at the old Regina building. Mm-hmm. That is no more. And Joy Finfera was our secretary, and she really kept us organized.
Joy Finfera, who's now the secretary of the congregation.
Yes.
So you broke her in?
I guess so.
Well, those were happy days. Did you each have a certain state or section? Or
area, yes.
Area.
We did.
And
we
what
did.
Was your?
Yeah. What well, was your, part of it was in Florida, and then I had the South Carolina people.
So you could visit home.
Yeah, that's true.
On one of those mm-hmm. one of those visits. Mm-hmm. I'm presuming your mother and father had a long life.
My mother died when she was in her 60s, but she had had very bad cancer mm-hmm. and suffered quite a bit from that. My dad lived about 10 more years.
But no one has lived as long as you, correct?
But nobody in the family.
In your family.
Yeah, he was mm-hmm. about 75, I think.
Do you have nieces and nephews scattered around?
I have 16 of them.
Say that again, please.
I have 16 of them. Well, one's in heaven. Mm-hmm. Just died this past year. but I have 16 of them.
And where does the nephew live that helps you with your Facebook?
Oh, Kevin. All of his family live in Charleston, all eight of them. My mother, my sisters, my youngest sister's eight children, they all live in Charleston.
Is he the one that encouraged you to hook into Facebook?
Yes, yes. Kevin. God love him.
But now you say no, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
You know,
too complicated.
They're all now in their 50s and 60s and even 70s, you know. Yeah. Between my two brothers, I had eight. My one brother had two, and my other brother had six.
As we take a breath now and reflect on your beautiful life, Betty, who are some of the women or men or events that helped to shape your life?
I was principal in Superior in Aiken, South Carolina for 6 years, and the person who's here that always remembers that is Kathleen Voss.
Oh,
she
yes.
always said it was a very good year for her, so it's nice to hear that.
That's nice to hear that, yes.
Yeah. So, I think I was sent there because I was a native. Anyway.
Yes, and I believe there were some sisters or young women that entered from Aiken, as I recall. I think there was one in my
No, we have Kitty Bethay from Dillon.
Okay, nearby.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, and Laura Pouse was living in Columbia, South Carolina when she entered. She's not a native of South Carolina, but she was living there, and she came often to Springbank when I was there. Before she entered.
So, besides Aiken, what other person or place or event pops into your heart? I will never forget this.
Oh my, I've had a good life, and I'm grateful for all of it, all the people that have been part of it, mm-hmm. you know.
I have a sense that John, Father John Egan was...
Well, Father John Egan was a special friend, yeah. Mm-hmm. He died right before I went to Kenya. Heart attack. Mm-hmm. But he was a very, very, very dear friend of mine.
Yeah. What about Sister Helen Thomas? I know
Helen Thomas was my superior for 6 years, and I thought the moon and sun set on her. Well, I loved Helen,
yes.
You know. But when I was in Hollywood, I had Sister Bibiana, and I loved her. She was a sweet, almost like a little mother, Bibiana.
And you also had Sister Dorothy Gettler as a student.
Oh, I only taught her that one class, mm-hmm. Latin.
And that was in Fort Pierce.
Yeah, so she was in the high school, and I was teaching in the junior high.
Can I draw the conclusion that other than Adrian, you've never been missioned in the North?
No, I've never been missioned any place except in Florida and South Carolina. Many years in Florida, mm-hmm. You know, in Hollywood, in Fort Pierce, in Jacksonville.
Was it a difficult adjustment when you came?
When I first came to Adrian, mm-hmm. I was reading my autobiography, and I said, these people up here are a little different than I'm used to.
Where are the palm trees? All I see are cornfields. But when you retired and came back and began living with Barbara in...
And Regina.
Regina.
I was very grateful for that. I was 80. My sister's adult children gave me an 80th birthday. And we had about 40 people that they knew were close to me in some way, and they served a whole meal. And it was a beautiful time. I have an album of it, mm-hmm. that I've kept.
How beautiful.
Yeah.
Did you say when you arrived, where are my winter clothes that I left here many years ago?
Well, Rosemary Abramovich was in charge then, mm-hmm. and she was a very welcoming, loving person, you know, and she knew this apartment was available that we could live in. So we lived there together for 8 years. Mm-hmm. All together, Barbara and I lived together 19 years.
Mm-hmm. So it was an easy adjustment coming from the South to the North for retirement.
Well, I couldn't exactly say easy, but I was grateful. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't want to retire in the South and just be there. Mm-hmm. The community is so important to me. I wanted to be in community. And Barbara was 75, too, so she was ready to come. Mm-hmm. Of course, she is from Michigan.
Closer to home.
Yeah, and yes. We often used to go to her sister's home when we were able.
What I recall is when she came here, retired to Adrian, you did continue with some spiritual direction.
No, I did spiritual direction. They asked me at Weber if I would do that, and mm-hmm. we both did it. I did it for quite a few years, mm-hmm. you know, and I loved it. Several of the people that I directed were directors themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, that was, in a sense, we could end up sharing, you know.
Have you observed in your life, Betty, a change in the prayers you say, or the sense of your spirituality over the years? In our elder years, what prayer is
way
important
back
to
when
you?
I was at Jacksonville, I had a special experience that God gave to me that helped me to know that I was in love with God. And everything that I think has been part of my life since then has been based on that, you know.
Beautiful.
And I'm very grateful for that, mm-hmm. awareness of God in my life.
May I ask this personal question? Is silence more important to you or verbal prayer?
Well, there is a rhythm to it, and both are important. I try to... plug into morning prayer often in my apartment. Mm-hmm. I don't go over to chapel, but I pray with them. And same thing in Vespers, you know. But, you know, when you talk about silent prayer, there's something about a prayer that's just a part of you. And it just comes out. I mean, it's just there. I don't know how to express
it. And there, no words are necessary.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't mind being quiet, and I don't mind being alone.
Beautiful. Well, thank you, Betty. And I'm so in awe of your beautiful life. And a commitment early on. Didn't someone say, well, you'll be teaching the black children for a long, long time?
Well, my dad said that I said I wanted to teach in the black community, but I didn't have a chance to until we were free to make our option, and then I did.
And
I have some very, very beautiful African-American friends who still keep in touch, call me.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, and I'm humbled at that.
God bless you, and thank you for this moment.
Thank you, Jody.